A very warm welcome to you, church, and a very happy new year to you all. And we wish to welcome you to worship here at Wisbeach Salvation Army. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. As you can see, I stand in a very empty Salvation Army worship hall, a hall that not too long ago was absolutely brimming with life, filled with Christmas hampers amidst the busy Advent season in which we have just served. This morning, we're going to be conducting our worship through virtual means only. And this is because we wish to heed the side of caution this day amidst the COVID-19 variant. But hopefully, all being well, we'll wish to be back for live worship from the 9th of January. Apologies for those who are hoping to be with us this morning physically, but we're also thankful for the means of technology and the means to be able to broadcast this morning's meeting to you. And with that in mind, we're going to be focusing this morning on courageous faith. And in particular, we're going to be looking at Rahab and the courageous faith that she had in the Lord. We're going to be deriving our teaching and our worship this morning from second chapter of Joshua, and not only explaining and exploring the context of Rahab's courageous faith, but also what that courageous faith means to us in the midst of this brand new year, 2022. And it is our prayer this morning that we're able to embody that courageous faith ahead of this new year and ahead of whatever context our lives hold. But before we do that, we wish to share in a word of prayer with you this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord of Lords, King of Kings, we just come before your throne of grace this morning, and we come with thankful hearts. Thankful, Lord, for what the Advent season represented for us, the coming of your Son Jesus, and the atoning sacrifice he would later do for our salvation. Father, as we just worship this morning through virtual means, we just pray, Lord, that your Spirit will be in our hearts and in our surroundings this morning. Pray for my friends this morning, Lord, that you would just dwell close to them this day, and may you just be what they need you to be. But Lord, we just come with thankful hearts this morning, and may you just be in our worship this day. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining with me in that prayer. And as we just worship together this morning through this online platform, it is my prayer that you are able to seek the Lord meaningfully, that his Spirit is able to dwell in your hearts. And as we explore the concept of courageous faith, we just pray that the Lord will be with you. May we just worship through these songs just now, and may we give this time to the Lord.
Names. Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb.
I hope that those songs managed to cultivate a worshipful spirit in your hearts today. And now we're going to be approaching our time of prayerful ministry this morning. And this morning, I want the prayers to be focused in around the Advent season that has just passed. As you can see behind me, and as I mentioned earlier in the meeting, the hall now is a very different place to how it was before. Everything that you see in this room was absolutely chock-a-full of boxes, toys, food, and actually the spirit of the Advent season. And it is with this direction in which we are going to be focusing our prayers today. We're going to be focusing on the season of Advent and actually all the people that we managed to engage with over this Christmas season. Salvation Army is renowned for many things over the Christmas period, but one thing that we take pride in is extending our hands to our community and meeting the needs as best we can, and just facilitating that spirit of Advent. So to celebrate this and to prayerfully consider our thoughts this morning, I'm going to be showing you a video of the images collected over the season of Advent, all the preparations, all the ministries that we managed to do. And I want you to pray for the people, pray for the families in which you have been in contact with us, and focusing in on the theme of this meeting, the courage of faith. We just pray that God's Spirit will be with them this morning, that they themselves will feel that sense of investment from God, that they feel worthy to be called and to be loved. So as this video plays, I just encourage you to pray for those who have been in touch with us over this Christmas season. And actually, whatever the prayers of your hearts and minds this morning, may this space just be meaningful for you and however you want to spend time with God today. So, let us pray together. This morning's Bible reading is, as I mentioned earlier, taken from Joshua chapter 2. And this morning I'm going to be reading from verses 1 to 11. So that's Joshua chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. And I encourage you to have your Bibles on hand to follow me along this morning, as I do not have some words on the screen for you today. But without further ado, Joshua chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. And I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation. And the word says this: Then Joshua secretly sent out two spies from the Israelite camp at Acacia Grove. He instructed them, scout out the land on the other side of the Jordan River, especially around Jericho. So the two men set out and came to the house of the prostitute named Rahab and stayed there for the night. But someone told the king of Jericho, some Israelites have come here tonight to spy out the land. So the king of Jericho sent orders to Rahab, bring out the men who have come into your house, for they have come here to spy the whole land. Rahab had hidden the two men, but she replied, yes, the men were here earlier, but I don't know where they were from. They left the town at dusk as the gates were about to close, and I don't know where they went. If you hurry, you can probably catch up to them. Actually, she had taken them up to the roof and hidden them beneath the bundles of flax she had laid out. So the kingsmen went for the spies along the river leading to the shallow crossings of the Jordan River. And as soon as the kingsmen had left, the gates of Jericho were shut. Before the spies went to sleep that night, Rahab went up to the roof to talk with them. I know the Lord has given you this land, she told them. We are all afraid of you. Everyone in the land is living in terror. For we have heard how the Lord made a dry path for you through the Red Sea when you left Egypt. And we know what you did to Sihon and Og, the two Amorite kings east of the Jordan River, whose people you completely destroyed. No wonder our hearts have melted in fear. No one has the courage to fight after hearing such things. For the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below. And may God add a blessing to his word this morning. Amen. To help pad out the context in which we derive our Bible reading this morning, we have a short clip to show you, explaining the context of Rahab and the courageous faith that she displayed.
The Faithful Hall of Fame, Rahab. This is Rahab.
Hi.
Rahab lived in the town of Jericho in the Promised Land. Rahab was not an Israelite, and she made bad choices.
Huh?
But God had a plan for Rahab, even though she was a sinner.
Ah, all right!
Now God told his people, the Israelites,
hey, that's us,
to go into the Promised Land. So Joshua sent two spies to search the land around the city of Jericho. The two spies came to Rahab's house to stay the night. But the king of Jericho heard that there were spies in his city, so he sent orders for Rahab to bring them out. But Rahab hid the spies. And told the king's men that it was true that the men were at her house, but she did not know where they were now. She told the king's men to go quickly to find the spies, because they could not have gone far. So the king's men rushed out to the city in pursuit of the Israelite spies. All the while, the Israelites hid on Rahab's roof. So Rahab went to them and said, "I know the Lord has given you this land. We have heard of the great acts that God has done for you. Your God is the God of all the heavens and the earth. So please swear to me that you will be kind to my family." The spies agreed to this, and Rahab helped them escape from the city. Before they left, they told Rahab to tie a scarlet rope to the window.
Yeah!
Whoa!
Oops!
This rope would serve as a mark for Rahab's house and would remind the Israelites of their promise to her.
Thank you!
Oh, thank you!
And so, the spies were on their way. For 3 days, they hid from the king's men who were looking for them. Finally, they returned to Joshua and told them all they had seen. Rahab was remembered for her faithfulness, for she had given a friendly welcome to the spies and put her trust in the one true God.
Content with the things that we need.
Lighten our darkness, breathe on this flame until your justice burns brightly again, until the nations learn of your ways, seek your salvation and bring you
It is my blessing and privilege to just be sharing in the Word of God with you today. But before we do that, let's just share an opening prayer together. And Father, may I just be an instrument of your Word and a vessel of your Spirit this day. Father, we just pray that these scriptures will come alive in our hearts as we just explore the depths of courageous faith. In Jesus' powerful name we pray. Amen. I will say one of the advantages of conducting worship virtually is the freedom to conduct it wherever I please. For those who see me on a Sunday know that I wander about as I preach and conduct worship, and that's been very much the case in today's worship as I've conducted worship in various parts of the hall. And you may have noticed I have done so, I'm taking the liberty of taking this message from my office, because those who do attend the Salvation Army would also know that my own office is a tad on the messy and cluttered side. So you know what, take advantages where we please. But in the spirit of today's message, I want us just to think about life. Life can be complicated, can it not? There's so many variants of life that make it complicated. And these last few years alone have emphasized that through COVID-19 and how life has radically changed for all of us. But another element of life that is complicated is people. People can be complicated, can they not? And you know what? That's very much the same as us. We ourselves can be complicated. But being complicated isn't necessarily a bad thing. Being complicated also emphasizes the point that we are uniquely and wonderfully made. So when someone calls you complicated, make of that as you will. But being complicated was very much within our message today and goes for Rahab as well. She was considered a complicated person of society. But just thinking of a real life example of complicated people, there is somebody in our church who I obviously will not name, but somebody in our church who is a wonderful man of God. Somebody who is an absolute blessing to be around. And somebody he himself considers himself to be complicated. And one thing that really fills his heart with joy is being able to do the collection every Sunday. Something so trivial to others means the absolute world to this particular individual. And you know what? That sense of fulfillment and responsibility brings out the best in this person. And you know what? It's not just that job that brings out the best in him, but actually the church community. The church community and that sense of purpose and that sense of spirit brings out the best in complicated people. And that message goes not only for ourselves, but also for Rahab as well. Now, Rahab, just to put you into context, was considered a very lowly member of society. She was a prostitute. She was somebody who was looked down upon, somebody who was very literally living on the outskirts of society, as her dwelling was built into the actual city walls itself. Somebody who was very literally on the edge of society. And yet, she was used to great purpose for the kingdom of God. It was her faith in God, and God choosing Rahab as well, that brought out the best in this complicated person. Complicated people serving complicated people. A message for ourselves this day, is it not? Now, Rahab is the very centre of this chapter. Aside from Joshua himself, Rahab is the only character to be named in all of chapter 2. There is a deliberate focus on Rahab, somebody of lowly, considerable worth. And it is this focus in which we're going to be channeling our focus into today. For Rahab had executed and conducted herself with courageous faith in God. So no matter her station, no matter who she was for society, she operated with courageous faith and was used to great effect. But the question still remains, why? Why Rahab's dwelling were the spies directed to go to there? Of all the places in town and of all the people that God could direct the spies to, why Rahab? Well, there's three reasons. First, of course, was it was a great place to gather intel. Joshua and the Israelites were on the brink of war, and Rahab's place was a great place for this reconnaissance. Secondly, Rahab's dwelling, as I've mentioned before, built into the city walls itself, operated as a great escape route, should the need arise. But the third, and actually the most important reason why the spies were directed to Rahab's, was that God had known and knows the heart of Rahab. She was open to God, and God had sensed this, and that is why the spies were sent to Rahab. Rahab was instrumental for the upcoming Israelite victory. And this is what I'm so encouraged by, friends. God often uses complicated people, people who consider themselves lowly, to do extraordinary things for the kingdom. And you know what? That message goes for ourselves today. We may consider ourselves to be complicated people, people who don't have much stakes in society. But you know what? Scriptures declare that God uses such people to great and extraordinary effect. And you know what? Though there's no congregation in front of me, I can't help but say hallelujah and praise God to be able to operate with such privilege and blessing through his gracious faith in us. No matter of their past, no matter of their deeds, we are all redeemable and we all will be used mightily. Paul, in his very last words, in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9, says this, "For God saved us and called us to live a holy life. He did this not because we had deserved it, but because this was his plan from before the beginning of time, to show us his grace through Christ Jesus." It was his plan from the very beginning to use complicated people for the extent of his kingdom through his grace, through Jesus Christ. What a blessing that is, friends. Coming back to the context in which we bring our Bible reading, Rahab had operated with courageous faith to aid God's people. But it was out of this deep sense of conviction that she did so boldly. You will see in Hebrews that God had used Rahab despite being the only one in Jericho to believe the word and heart of God. Rahab in the entire city of Jericho knew of God's depths, of his power, of his majesty. And that is why God had used her, because she had the conviction of faith. If we operate with such conviction, we too will be victorious in being made useful for the kingdom. And that is an amazing, amazing thought. She acknowledged Jehovah God, and you will see that in verses 8 to 10. But women of faith have been throughout the whole Bible, and actually Jesus in Luke's gospel paraphrased this in the love and grace that can be lavished on us. Now, all of this stems from the love of Jesus he has for us. arguably the most well-known scripture is taken from John's Gospel. John chapter 3, verse 16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." If we but anchor ourselves to him, if we encompass our direction in our faith in God, we will be victorious, friends. In the wake of 2022, this new year that beckons, we must operate with courageous faith in the convictions in which we believe. It is then that the victory will then be ours, that we will get that gratification in our hearts, that warm sense of knowing what is right and what feels right. That is what comes from his Spirit. Now, the entire gospel comes into focus in this singular verse in John. God's love is not static. It is not self-centered. But it makes and reaches out and draws others in. The love of God goes for all. And we as his church have that charge to show that love of God, to show that courageous faith and make all the difference to our friends and the community in which we serve. This is why we do what we do at Christmas time. We are living out that gospel message because we love, because he loved first. Now, Rahab, in her faithfulness, inadvertently entered the grand line and genealogy of Jesus when she chose to believe and focus in on God. The key, friends, to consider is that Rahab had operated out of courageous faith in God to embark upon this path. Out of God's love and grace that she would be so mightily used, a complicated person being used to serve complicated people. And if you were to take away one thing from this message, friends, it is this. The only qualification that Rahab needed was faith and obedience in God. No matter her station and no matter what, she had faith and obedience in God and had operated with courageous faith. Friends, wherever you find yourselves at the start of this new year, wherever you want to channel your focus in this day and even beyond, friends, I just encourage you to operate with that courageous faith in God, the one who sent his Son for the atonement of our sins. Friends, I just pray that you'll be filled with his Spirit and what you need to encompass yourself on this day, I just pray that the Lord will help you find it. Before we close, we're going to be worshipping through a song, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer," because it is through his guidance that we encompass our direction. Something Rahab had done in years past, something that we do this very day. "Guide me, O Thou Great Jehovah." Friends, I want to thank you so much for worshipping with us this day. And hopefully we'll be back to live worship again from 9th of January. But friends, as always, we just pray that God's blessing will be upon you, and may God bless you this happy new year.